night's event. This evening, I am excited to introduce Chris Myers Asch and George Derek Musgrove, authors of the book Chocolate City, A History of Race and Democracy in the Nation's Capital. Before I introduce our authors this evening, I would like to direct you to enter any questions you have throughout the program, wherever you are streaming this program from. There will be a Q&A session following their presentation, and we would love to hear from you and answer some of your questions. And now I would like to introduce our guests for this evening. A native of Washington, D.C., Chris Myers Asch teaches history at Colby College and runs the Capital Area New Mainers Project, which helps immigrants and refugees adjust to life in central Maine. He is the co-author with George Derek Musgrove of Chocolate City, A History of Race and Democracy in the Nation's Capital, and the author of The Senator and the Sharecropper, The Freedom Struggles of James O. Eastland and Fannie Lou Hamer. He and his wife have three children and live in Hallowell, Maine. George Derek Musgrove is an associate professor of history and Africana studies at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. He is the author of Rumor, Repression, and Racial Politics, How the Harassment of Black Elected Officials Shaped Post-Civil Rights America, and co-author with Chris Myers Asch of Chocolate City. His latest project is Black Power in Washington, D.C., a web-based map of Black Power activism in the nation's capital between 1961 and 1998. His work has appeared in the Washington Post, National Public Radio, the New York Times, and The Root. He is currently working on a book project tentatively titled, We Must Take to the Streets Again, The Black Power Resurgence in Conservative America, 1980 to 1997, which explores the burst of Black activism that rose in opposition to the urban crisis and conservative retrenchment. He earned his PhD from New York University in 2005, and now lives with his wife and two sons in Washington, D.C. It is so wonderful to have you both this evening. And without any further ado, I will turn it over to you guys for tonight, this first portion of tonight's program. And remember for audience to ask your questions as we go. Welcome.
Well, thank you, Lena.
Thank you so much for having us.
And thanks to all of you for joining us this afternoon. We're gonna just do four things, talk to you all for the first 20 minutes, and then we're gonna turn it back over to Lena to field questions from the audience. And so those four things that we're gonna do in the time that we're sort of speaking directly to you are to really talk about, you know, sort of how we came to write Chocolate City, why we chose the name Chocolate City and the argument implicit in that name, why people outside of DC should care about DC history. And then because we're on White House History Live, we're going to end by talking about some our favorite stories from the book that take place in Washington Square Park right across from the White House. And so we'll begin just by talking about how we came to write the book. So, you know, when it for my case, because, you know, Chris and I had our different reasons for writing this. I ended up writing this book because one of my classes was canceled at the University of the District of Columbia. I was scheduled to teach African American history back in about 2009 or so, and we had a policy at the school where if one of your classes didn't fill up, it was canceled right then and there on the first day, and you were given another class. And the only other class available was DC history, and so I really rapidly learned DC history, not fast enough, I think, for my students' tastes, and so it was a rough semester. And when I met Chris about a year and a half later, I told him about this crazy semester I had had where I was sort of learning DC history as I was teaching it. And, you know, I kind of ended the conversation with Chris by saying, God, I really wish I had had, you know, a really good single volume history of Washington, DC that I could have used either to prepare my lecture notes or even to assign to the students. And Chris was unnaturally quiet when I told this story, which actually had some real zingers in it. I had a lot of characters in my class. And the reason that he was so quiet, Chris is going to tell you about now.
So yes, and want to echo Derek's thanks for having us, for joining us on this weekend. It's always strange to be talking here. I'm in Central Maine, Derek's down in DC, and you all are all over the country, presumably. But it's really great to be able to share some of this history with you all. And for me, you know, the reason why I was so excited to talk with Derek about DC history and work on this project with him from the beginning is because I'm from DC. I grew up in DC in the 80s when DC was not growing and you know, people were not flocking to the city. It was a tough time during DC's history. And I remember I was at Deal Junior High School, and we had to take DC history as part of our required curriculum. I think seniors now have to take it. It's not a ninth grade course anymore. But there I was sitting in ninth grade, and our teacher was telling us about the DC history class that we were about to take, a semester long course. And she said, look, I just want to let you know, we'll spend about six weeks or so talking about DC history. And then we're going to move on to the second part of the course, which was world history, which she was much more interested in. And she said, the reason is, you know, DC doesn't really have much history. And that comment kind of stuck with me. I mean, I didn't know any better. I was ninth grade. I didn't know DC history, but it stuck with me because there was something just wrong about that. Like, why would a teacher sort of undermine her own subject matter? And also, why would somebody teaching DC public school students, a DC teacher, why would she undermine the history? And as I've gotten older, you know, went off to college and I've lived in different places around the country, I've come to realize just how representative that idea is for many Americans, because DC largely does not get the respect it deserves from the nation that it serves. You know, we Washingtonians struggle to be heard. We struggle to be treated as full Americans. And I think most of the rest of the country really has very little idea about the city or its history or its people. And so for me, it's kind of the revenge narrative. You know, I wanted to right this wrong. I wanted to best this teacher and show her that no, DC really does have a history. It's a very long and rich history. It's complicated. It's not always pretty. It's going to make us uncomfortable, but it's a real and rich history that all Americans should learn.
And so these were sort of our personal paths to the book. But the one thing that we knew, and by the way, you know, Chris sort of went off after I told him this story and very quietly put together a book proposal and just sent it to me in an email and said, you know, that book that you really wish you had in your DC history class, we should write it. And it wasn't just because he wanted to sort of seek revenge on this teacher from ninth grade. And it wasn't just because I had a bunch of notes that I had feverishly written and now wanted to use in helping Chris to draft a book. It was also because both of us understood when we were exchanging those emails and having those conversations in 2010, going into 2011, that there was a huge group of people here in Washington, D.C. that wanted a book like what we envisioned Chocolate City to be. Remember, back then, the city is changing at breakneck speed. About 1,000 new residents are coming into town every single day. We now know that a couple hundred older residents were actually moving out of the city. I'm sorry, every day, every month. And we now know that about 100 or so, a couple hundred or so older residents were being pushed out of the city every month as well. During that period. So the city's really changing. You had a lot of older residents who didn't want the history that they knew to be forgotten. A lot of younger residents who wanted to understand their adopted home's history and wanted to know what they were getting into. And so we knew that there were all these people that wanted this history. And we also realized that no one had written a sort of large synthetic history of DC focused on issues of race since 1967, when Constance Greene wrote her wonderful book, The Secret City. And so we thought that we had a lot to add to the story and we jumped right in. Now, why did we call it Chocolate City? I'll just point out before I jump into this that our conversation about what we should call the book lasted a couple of seconds. Chris said, what should we call it? I said, I think we should call it Chocolate City. He said, perfect, let's move on. That was that. And so what we want to do now is really tell you some of the history about that nickname, Chocolate City, and the argument implicit in that name. I think I'm a little off of our normal process, Chris, but you want to go ahead and jump in here?
No, you know, it's interesting because the name, I mean, we wanted something catchy, something that captured the spirit of the book, of course. But what's interesting is the reaction that I've often gotten about that name, certainly when we were working on the book. I remember shortly after these conversations with the book proposal, I was having dinner with my wife's family out in Bethesda, and I mentioned that this new project I was working on with my friend Derek, and we're going to write about race in DC. The book's going to be called Chocolate City, and it's going to be really. And my wife's cousin got really nervous. Her mouth dropped open. She, eyes got wide. She said, "What did you say?" And I said, "We're going to call it Chocolate City." She said, "Isn't that racist? Are we even allowed to say that?" And I thought that was interesting because I've gotten that reaction from many white people in different contexts. In fact, they won't even let me call that the course I teach on race in DC Chocolate City because they're worried about misinterpretation. What's funny is because it didn't cross my mind because growing up in the 80s, I mean, that's just what the city was called. That's just what it was. But I think it's very interesting because what it speaks to is it speaks to this moment in DC history, this half century period, really starting in 1957 when the Census Bureau declares that DC is the first major U.S. city to have a black majority population. Extending all the way into the 21st century, when DC really becomes the center of black culture and black politics, and is the capital of black America and embraces this name Chocolate City. And that's the city I grew up in. But I think it's interesting that many white people recoil from that. They recoil and think there must be something negative about a term that highlights the blackness of the city. Which I didn't have growing up in the city, and something that we wanted to highlight, because one of the arguments implicit in this book is that DC is basically a chocolate city from the founding, in the sense that race and the black experience, the presence of a large and visible and vocal black community, is the central animating feature of DC history. And if you don't understand race and the black experience in the city, you're going to really struggle to understand the city's history at all, because DC is not only the capital of the United States of America, but throughout its history, it's played the role of being the capital of Black America as well.
And this was the city, this is how I came to understand Washington, DC. I am not a native. I grew up in Baltimore, Maryland, but my father was a huge fan of Parliament Funkadelic, which of course, in 1975, cut the wonderful album Chocolate City, which is literally an homage to Washington, D.C. and its black majority. And so when I thought of Washington, D.C., I thought of really the things that many native D.C. residents thought about when they uttered those words. And that was the black majority, which was, of course, D.C., as Chris pointed out, was the first major city to be a black majority. And it was one of the blackest cities in the United States of America. When Parliament cuts that album, DC is roughly 73% African American, more than half a million African Americans are packed in the city. But we all know, looking at sort of Ferguson, Missouri in the last couple of years, that a black majority doesn't make a great city, necessarily make a great black experience. What DC also had was just all of this black culture bursting off of the streets of the city. It was a place where poets like Gaston Neal were regularly giving poetry slams in Washington, D.C., and Amiri Baraka was coming down from Newark, New Jersey to join those slams. It was a place where DCPS teachers like Roberta Flack were cutting classic albums, which were being shipped all across the country. And it was a place where someone like Chuck Brown was creating an entirely new form of music, which, of course, we now know as go-go. And so it was a black majority creating a huge amount of black culture. And at the very time that Parliament cuts that album in 1975, DC gets a local government that is seated in January 1975 for the first time in 100 years after not having a local government for that entire time. And so you also have black political power, because that government wasn't just a black government, but it was a government peopled with civil rights and black power and anti-poverty activists. And so it was really a movement style government. And so the celebration was really all wrapped up in that word. And that's how I had come to know it. That's how Chris grew into it. What we found out, though, as we rolled it out for the name, was that that's actually not how a large number of people outside of the city viewed that term. And we are dead set on changing that. Now, speaking of people outside the city, we want to talk really quickly about why people outside of D.C. should care about DC history. We think that everybody in America should buy this book. We don't understand why we haven't had a solid 300 million plus sales yet. And we'd like you to tell all your friends to please buy this book, not only for themselves, but also for their entire families and their associates. The reason we think that people should understand DC history, and specifically the idea of race in DC history, is that DC plays an outsized role in the popular imagination of the United States because it is the nation's capital. And it plays three specific roles. The first one is that it is a stage where the pageantry of American democracy takes place. All of our inaugurals are here. The Congress meets here. The president lives here and works from the Oval Office. The Supreme Court, of course, meets right behind Congress on Capitol Hill. And so literally the functioning of American democracy takes place here. And that means that this land, this stage, is actually one in which DC residents have the opportunity, even though they're not necessarily welcome on that stage, to sort of enter into the American drama and to become actors in that drama if they can somehow get into the play. But Chris is gonna tell you some of the other reasons that DC history is important to folks outside the city.
So DC is the stage, right? What happens in DC never stays in DC. It's not like Vegas, right? I mean, what happens, it's the nation's living room. People are watching. And so it also becomes this battleground. And so a lot of times these national battles that we're fighting, especially over race, are actually taking place in DC about what's happening in DC. I mean, take the abolitionist movement, for example, the grand fight to end slavery, probably the greatest social movement in American history. The early abolitionist movement in the early 1830s was focused almost entirely on ending slavery in Washington, D.C. Abolitionists wanted to end it everywhere, but they focused first on D.C., A, because it's a symbol of American democracy, and they said it's a stain on the national reputation for slavery and the slave trade to exist in the nation's capital, but B, also for pragmatic reasons, because D.C. then, as now, is not a state. It does not have full rights. Congress is in control. And so Congress, if it wanted to, could end slavery in DC today. And abolitionists called on them. If you go to the Library of Congress and read the yellowing petitions from the 1830s and early 1830s from you know, every little town in America, what they're calling for is they're calling on Congress to use their power, their control over the District of Columbia, to end slavery and the slave trade in the nation's capital. And it got so bad for slave owners in Congress that they said enough. And they passed what were called the Pinckney Resolutions, 1836, saying, we're not even going to mention the word slavery. You can't even talk about slavery. This lasted for 8 years. You talk about putting your head in the sand. I mean, 8 years, they said, you can't even mention slavery on the floor of this chamber, because they were so sick of abolitionists talking about D.C. I mean, William Lloyd Garrison called it the first citadel to be carried. And on the flip side, John C. Calhoun, slave-owning senator from South Carolina, said, look, this is our Thermopylae. We have to defend slavery in D.C. If we lose it in D.C., we're going to lose it everywhere. And so battles, national battles over race often take place in D.C., about D.C. Same thing happens with school desegregation 100 years later after Bowling v. Sharp, which is the companion case to Brown v. Board of Education, where Dwight Eisenhower said, look, we have to integrate the schools in D.C. because the whole world is watching. We have to do it in America's capital. And the segregationists on the other side said, no, you know, we have to defend it in D.C. and we're going to make hay of any effort you make to try to integrate the schools in D.C., right? So battles over national policy often take place in D.C. So it's a stage, it's a battleground, and as Derek will tell you, it's also a laboratory.
Yeah, and as Chris pointed out, I mean, the reason that Congress can treat D.C. as a battleground or as a laboratory is because of Article 1, Section 8, Clause 17 of the Constitution, which effectively says that Congress has a power of exclusive legislation over the national capital. And so it's able to meddle in city affairs, and it often does. When members of Congress are thinking about taking a policy national, but they don't necessarily have the support within the Congress to actually vote that policy through for the rest of the country, they'll sometimes try it out, you know, use DC as a laboratory to see if the policy works, and then say to their colleagues, see, it worked in DC, let's try it elsewhere in the country. And so, like Chris, I'll give you a couple of examples. Sometimes this works wonderfully for DC residents, at least the ones that we champion in the book. In the 1860s, remember, many of the Democrats in Congress leave the United States of America to go form their own nation founded on slavery, the Confederacy. And that leaves Republicans basically in charge in Congress in the United States House and Senate. And so what they do, particularly among the radical Republicans in that caucus, is that they try out policies. They're trying to convince their more moderate colleagues to try out in the rest of the country. And that works out really well for African-Americans in DC. In 1862, radical Republicans convinced the rest of the Republican Party to push the DC Compensated Emancipation Act. And it ends slavery for the roughly 3,100 individuals still held in bondage in the District of Columbia. And the federal government actually tries out the process of compensating their owners. And this is all before the Emancipation Proclamation takes effect. What Congress realizes from that experiment is that compensation is really expensive and it doesn't seem to grease the wheels any. So we're just going to go ahead and straight up do emancipation without compensation. And that comes in 1863 and then again in 1865 through the Emancipation Proclamation and the 13th. Amendment. But Congress keeps doing this during the Reconstruction period. In 1867, really early in the year, Congress passes the Negro Suffrage Act, which allows African-American men in the district to vote. And again, this is before the 14th Amendment sort of kicks in and allows for Black voting across the rest of the South. And so Congress is constantly pushing the envelope, trying out these policies that it's willing to take to the rest of the country during the Civil War and Reconstruction. Now, fast forward approximately 130 years, another group of radical Republicans comes to the Capitol, and this is Newt Gingrich's Republican takeover of 1994. It just so happens that around the same time, the district goes bankrupt. Going into 1995, we post a $700 million deficit. And so Congress takes over the functioning of the city with a financial control board. And at that point, Jack Kemp, who's advising Newt Gingrich, and Newt Gingrich and many Republicans themselves, say, let's try out all of these pro-market reforms that we want to implement nationwide, but we don't quite have agreement within our larger conference to try. And so they try all types of tax abatements, school vouchers, charter schools, dramatically cutting taxes, all types of privatization in DC. And then they begin to roll out those policies, at least the ones that they can get consensus for on a national level. And so you can see Congress consistently experimenting with the city for good and ill in both eras throughout the city's history. Now, before we turn this over to question and answer, we just want to tell you two quick stories about Lafayette Park. And so I'm going to let Chris go so that we tell them in chronological order.
Yeah, and you know, Lafayette Park plays obviously a key role, and it's very much part of this idea of DC being both the national capital and this battleground, this stage, this battleground, this laboratory. You know, a lot of that happens right there on Lafayette Square. You know, when I think about Lafayette Square, I think of a woman named Alethea Browning Tanner, who was born enslaved in PG County. And she ran a vegetable stand while enslaved. She would bring her vegetables in and had a vegetable stand near Lafayette Park, and had many, you know, Thomas Jefferson was one of her customers, used that vegetable stand to save up money, and actually saved up enough money by 1810, she saved up the equivalent of about $30,000 in today's money to buy her own freedom, which she did. So she buys her own freedom, keeps the stand going, keeps saving money, and doesn't just stop there. She's like the financial Harriet Tubman. She keeps going back and she keeps saving money and freeing first her family and you know, her nieces and nephews and sister and then her close friends. After a couple decades of doing this, she has freed about 25 people, including her nephew, John F. Cook, who goes on to become an educator, opens up a private school for Black children, which ends up being being destroyed and ransacked in a white mob riot in 1835. But then his son, John F. Cook Jr., becomes very active in the free black community in the 1850s and 60s and runs for office during Reconstruction and wins. He becomes the first black man elected to citywide office in the city, in the country. And so, you know, so when I think of what she had to do, Alethea Browning Tanner had to do, you know, the discipline and the courage and the sacrifice she made to open up opportunities for more than two dozen people, and all the opportunities that all of them then followed and opened up. It's easy to see how DC becomes this beacon of opportunity and freedom, even within slavery. Right. If you were an enslaved person, you were trying to get free and you were on a plantation in Maryland or Virginia, North Carolina, you wanted to go to D.C. Right. Canada's too far away. New York's too. D.C. You could get there and you could become part of this thriving free black community that Alethea Browning Tanner and members of her family were building even before the Civil War.
And, you know, what one thing that Chris's story really speaks to is that, you know, Lafayette Square Park is this really interesting place where, you know, sort of the neighborhoods of Washington, D.C. and the common people of Washington, D.C. interact with the elite of Washington, D.C. And so the way that people who grew up here in the 70s and 80s used to say it is that it's the place where Washington, sort of elite, predominantly white, disproportionately rich, interacts with and even collides with D.C., focused on the neighborhoods, disproportionately African-American, far less affluent. And so what I want to talk about now is a really fascinating case from the late 1980s and early 1990s that actually explains why a jury refused to convict Marion Barry for felony drug possession when he was arrested back in 1990. So in 1989, George H.W. Bush has just been elected president, and he is about to roll out his new drug control policy. And so he actually focuses on D.C. first because his drug control policy is very expensive. It's going to violate a lot of people's rights, an expansion of policy is going to violate a lot of people's rights. And he needs to sort of build public support for it. So the first thing he does, he gets his Bill Bennett, who really distinguishes himself as education secretary under Reagan, but he comes in as a drug czar under George H.W. Bush, to announce this big drug control program. It's going to cost about $80 million. It's going to focus on Washington, D.C. And then Bush says, okay, what I want to do is help the police chief, who had just proceeded to lock up a huge number of young African Americans, to run for mayor against Marion Barry. And so they hold fundraisers for him. They do a ceremonial changing of his party affiliation from Democrat to Republican at the White House. Guy's name was Turner, Maurice Turner. And then they essentially, Bush says, okay, now I got to sort of go for the coup de grace. I want to go on TV in September 1989, and I want to tell the country about drugs and how bad they are, and to really drive home the idea of how bad drugs are here in D.C., in the nation's capital. I want to hold up a bag of crack cocaine that DEA agents have bought in Lafayette Square across the street from the White House. Because my God, if people are selling drugs across the street from the White House, they're selling them everywhere in America. And a DEA agent went back to Bush and said, you know, Mr. President, nobody sells drugs in Lafayette Square. That's crazy. Like, that would be the dumbest drug dealer in the world. And he just was so in love with the idea, he basically pressured the DEA to make it happen. So DEA agents, trying to impress the president, drove all the way across town to Southwest, picked up a high school age drug dealer, drove him back across town to Lafayette Square, bought drugs from him, and then arrested him. And it was those drugs that they bought from a young man who was a high school student named Keith Timothy Jackson that Bush holds up on TV in his first major primetime address in 1989. And when a Washington Post reporter, a guy named Michael Isikoff, you know, points out, like, hey, you know, didn't you like set some kid up to buy those drugs? Because nobody sells drugs in Lafayette Square. George Bush just says, does anybody really, you know, think that someone should defend this drug guy? He says this on the golf course. I mean, so out of touch, it's amazing. And when Keith Timothy Jackson is indicted on drug charges for selling that bag of crack in Lafayette Square, the jury gathered from people here in D.C. refuses to convict him because they say, look, it was a setup. The president set him up for a prop. And just a couple months later, Marion Barry, who had been set up by the FBI in a drug sting, when he goes before a similar jury and is charged with felony drug possession, they only convict him of a misdemeanor because most of them say it was a setup. And it's the same Justice Department that had gone after him that had gone after Keith Timothy Jackson. So Lafayette Square is this fascinating place where Washington and DC collide. And of course, when everything opens back up, it's also a place where the White House History Association is, and you should absolutely go by and check them out. We're going to turn things over to Lena, though, so we can get to some of your questions, which we see popping up in the chat. And we look forward to hearing them.
All right. Thank you so much. This is great. We do have a bunch of questions rolling in, but I wanted to start with a question of my own. So the association, we have been working on a project called Slavery in the President's Neighborhood for the past couple of years. And we've described a lot of these, this paradoxical relationship that exists between the concepts of freedom, the concepts of slavery in the nation's capital. And I think one thing that's particularly interesting is the location of, and selecting the location of Washington, D.C. And I was struck in your book by a quote from Mary Church Terrell, where she says, if it had been located in the North, East, or West, the status of colored people would be far better than it is. Mm-hmm. And so I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the impact of the physical location of Washington, D.C., and what that meant for slavery, also suffrage, and equality in the district.
Hmm. Sure, I'm happy to jump on that one. Of course, you know, DC becomes the location because of a deal that's struck at this, you know, what some historians call the most famous dinner party in America. It even, you know, as part of Lin-Manuel Miranda's Hamilton musical, right? The room where it happened, right? Madison and Jefferson, you sit down with Alexander Hamilton to hash out this deal, out of which comes the selection of D.C. or on the Potomac, that we're going to place the seat of the federal government on the Potomac. What's interesting is, as an aside, you know, part of the appeal of that song, the room where it happened. Of course, Aaron Burr is saying, well, no one else was there. It was just these three guys, which isn't true, right? Because who made the dinner? Who's serving? Well, Jefferson's enslaved chef and servants are serving the dinner. And you know, we write about this dinner, which is often portrayed as, you know, these three heavyweights, and that's it. You know, they're the only ones in the room where it happened. But enslaved people are there in the room where it happened. And I think it's kind of indicative of how we write and understand American history. Like, we follow the Jeffersons and the Hamiltons. They make the decisions. We don't even see the enslaved people who are making the dinner, who are, you know, who are building the White House and the Capitol. We don't even see them. For a long time, the historical profession wouldn't even acknowledge their existence, let alone the role that they play and the impact that they have on American history, or in DC history in particular. I mean, the fact that DC is a Southern city for all the way up to the present is profoundly important, right? That's why slavery exists in the city. That's part of why the Virginians, Jefferson and Madison, Washington as well, wanted so much for it to be in the South on the Potomac River, was because of slavery. There was a thriving slave trade on the Potomac River. Alexandria, which was part of DC until the 1840s, was the largest slave trading city in the entire country in the 1830s. And so this has a tremendous impact on DC's development as a city, because it is very much a Southern city. And yet it is also the capital of the Union Army during the Civil War, right? And so Lincoln has a really delicate task before him, because he can't let DC fall, and yet here it is across the river from Virginia, the heart of the Confederacy. And so he works very hard, and in sometimes confounding ways, when we look back, like, why is he bending over backwards for Maryland, right? Why is he making so many concessions to Maryland slave owners? It's because he has to. because he can't let the Union Army headquarters be surrounded by the enemy. And so he cuts many deals with Maryland and Kentucky. And he needs these border states to stay within the Union. And that has a tremendous impact on the course of DC history, right? The fact that we're the nation's capital and it's written into the Constitution that Congress has complete control. Well, that means that Washingtonians of all colors are really subject to the whim of Congress. And so when Congress desires, it can grant the vote, which it does. In the antebellum year, there was local government, there were mayors elected in, all the way through Reconstruction. And then in 1874, Congress says, no, we're gonna take that away. And we're gonna install three presidentially appointed commissioners. And they run the city for 100 years. And throughout that time, DC is a segregated Southern city. And yet it's different, right? Just as there was an abolitionist community in DC that didn't exist in much of the rest of the South, throughout the era of Jim Crow, there is an activist community within the Black community with roots in the antebellum free Black community that fights for against segregation. So streetcars were not segregated in DC as they were in the rest of the South. The Carnegie Public Library wasn't segregated as libraries were across the South. There were points at which the Black community rose up and fought against segregation. Black teachers were paid almost with parity with white teachers in the DC public school system. DC Black public school system became kind of the jewel of the national Black public education system because the Black community in DC fought so hard for it. But DC was a Southern city. And so if you look at the post-World War II civil rights era, many of the battles that were fought in the South had already been won in DC by the time Rosa Parks sits on that bus in Montgomery in 1955, but with one glaring exception, and that is the right to vote. And so after Selma and Big March and the Voting Rights Act, many civil rights activists, including Marion Barry and others involved in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, including Martin Luther King, they look at the landscape and they're like, what's going on in DC? I mean, we just marched for this. We got our heads beaten into this. We just passed a law about this. And Black folks and white folks in this Black majority city can't even vote. They don't even have a city government. They don't vote for anything. And so many of them move to DC precisely to work on these issues of political power. So the fact that DC sits on the Potomac and not on the Susquehanna, which it was the original vote, Congress originally thought the government was going to be in Pennsylvania, it has profound impact on the course of DC history.
Wonderful. We have a question from James on Facebook who asks, what's something that you found in your research that most DC residents, Black or white, might be surprised by?
So James, I mean, my big one was actually the George H.W. Bush example. Everyone who talks about Bush when he was alive, as well as after he passed, we used to talk about him as this gentleman. And, to certain groups of people, he really was a gentleman. But that was not the case when it came to poor Black people by and large. And the way that he treated DC, keep in mind that this is when DC is at its one of its lowest points in the late 20th century. The city's going broke. It's subject to a crack in a crime epidemic. And, rather than sort of come in trying to help the city, George H.W. Bush really uses it as a prop, as a political prop to sort of advance his programs. Programs that, by the way, local elected officials and bureaucrats had already announced didn't work. I mean, Maurice Turner basically says before Bush comes to town, this whole approach of just locking everybody up doesn't work. It just crowds our jails and the drug problem continues. And not only does Bush double down on that idea, but then he tries to get Maurice Turner to run for mayor as a Republican. It literally makes no sense. The other thing I'll say is that, and Chris and I sort of went down this rabbit hole, probably me a little bit more than Chris, is that, The different strategies that DC residents have adopted in their quest for voting representation in Congress from the 1970s to the present were, as a non-DC native, totally foreign to me. I knew that DC didn't have a vote, but I didn't know why, and I didn't know what residents had attempted to do in order to gain it. And so that became a focus of our research late in the book writing process. And we've actually written a bunch of op-eds and a report about it recently, trying to inform the larger debate about statehood that's going on now.
I'd love to jump into this just because, you know, I live in Maine now, and people in Maine, nothing against Maine. I mean, people in Maine love George H.W. Bush, by the way, because he used to have a place here. But they largely don't know anything about D.C. They don't even know that D.C. residents don't have the right to vote. So I think pretty much everything in Chocolate City is going to be a surprise to many Americans. But I know for me, you know, a couple things stand out. One, you know, thinking about Aletheia Browning Tanner and folks in the Andy Bellamy era, we often think of slavery as this kind of all-encompassing repressive regime where Black folks were just relentlessly, you know, oppressed, and they were victims, and it was just dehumanizing and horrible. And it was. But in D.C. and elsewhere, but more so in D.C., enslaved people working often together with their free Black kin sometimes or neighbors worked to create holes, create space for them, so create cracks in the system that they could squeeze through, and you see this in segregation too, where you know they'll find the weak point and they'll hammer home on that weak point, and you see over and over, you know, there's a woman, Nina Queen, who takes her case in 1813 all the way up to the Supreme Court and says, look, I am free based on my own oral history. I don't have any documentation, but my own family oral history going back generations shows that I'm free. And she takes this argument up to the Supreme Court. She loses her case, unfortunately, but there were hundreds of Black people who filed what were called freedom suits to gain their freedom, and many of them won, right? So it's not as if people were just hapless victims, right? They were actively pushing against slavery and against segregation in a variety of ways. And the other thing I'm going to say, especially to the white folks out there, is our depiction of Marion Barry. You know, when Marion Barry died a few years ago, there was hardly a white face in that crowd. And I think by and large, white people in D.C. and around the country see Marion Barry as this buffoonish, you know, two-dimensional villain, you know, the crack abusing, you know, crackhead mayor who drove D.C. into the ground. And growing up in D.C. as a white kid, I largely imbibed that. You know, I saw him get, you know, smoke that crack in the Vista Hotel when I was a senior in high school. Like, I had this visceral hatred of Marion Barry and what he was doing to our city. But as we come to, you know, and you see this in many of the books, especially the ones that came out in the 90s, you know, and he gets sent to jail, and there's one biography after another where Barry is just this villain. That's not what you'll read in Chocolate City. And it's something that surprised me the more I dug into it, the more Derek and I dug into the story. You really have to see Marion Barry in his totality. He is without doubt the most important political figure in D.C. history. And it's important to understand him in all his complexity. And that, you know, he's not this two-dimensional villain. He's really an extraordinary figure, very talented, very complicated. And we wind up depicting him more as this tragically flawed hero, you know, who's unable in the end to overcome his flaws. But he's heroic in his own way. And that's important to understand, and to understand why people would continue to vote him into office, knowing all of his foibles. Whereas someone like Adrian Fenty, who was widely loved in white circles, and especially in wealthy, you know, on the wealthy think tank circuit, you know, and everybody knew he was going to win re-election, and he got trounced. He disappeared from D.C. politics. How is it that these same voters rejected him and yet were sympathetic to Marion Barry? It's a complicated story and one that's worth exploring. And so to me, that was a bit of a surprise. And I think many of the particularly white Washingtonians and white Americans may be surprised by it.
So I wanted to combine sort of a couple questions together. There's one point in your book, and I forget who it is, but you're talking about an activist, and they say that they don't live in Washington, D.C. because they don't have the right to vote. And personally, I love DC. I study DC history. I work in DC, but I personally do not live in DC for the very same reason, because of the right to vote. So I think one of the interesting questions here, and something that Ari from Facebook has asked, is how does the fact that Washington DC has this Black majority, how has that played into this this voter suppression narrative as well? Is that a direct impact?
Yeah, you know, so we wrote this up in a recent report that we did with the Federal City Council called Democracy Deferred. And look, I mean, for the first 70 years of the city's history, Black voting doesn't matter to people in Congress, you know, and that's because voting is restricted in the city to white property holding men for the first couple of decades of the city's history, and then to white men after that, until the advent of the Negro Suffrage Act in 1867. And so you've got, you know, white aldermen and a white mayor for much of that time, but nobody's seriously considering Black voting as an option. I mean, this is a Southern Democratic slave city, right? It's really Reconstruction that changes the entire calculus about the relationship between the local government and Congress and in race, in issues of race. Once Black people start voting, race is at the center of those conversations. And so there's a biracial, sort of Republican government in the city from 1867, really 1868 until 1874. And that government is not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, but it bans discrimination. You can literally be fined in Washington, D.C. if you own a soda stand and you discriminate against African Americans. I mean, that's on the books as D.C. law. And in a sort of a counter-revolution against the democratic politics of that moment, local white elites who don't want not just Black people voting, but don't want poor people voting at all, sort of work with Democrats and conservative Republicans in Congress and strip everybody in the city of the vote for the next 100 years and put those three commissioners in charge. And the story that they tell at the time has everything to do with race. The Negro electorate was so irresponsible, they say, that it's just not safe to have anybody voting because they'll infect the larger process, right? And they tell that story over and over again when people want to return the franchise to the city in the 1890s, or when they want to return the franchise to the city in the 1930s, 1940s and 50s. They're still telling that story, right? And once you get to the 1950s, DC has a Black majority. And so you have a segregationist bloc in Congress that is determined not only to make sure that DC doesn't regain the vote because it will be a majority Black city, but also to make sure that as the city is currently constituted, Black folks don't get their just share of appropriations and services. And so you come to DC in the late 1950s, and it's Black neighborhoods that are being bulldozed by the federal government in urban renewal, or they're being targeted for the bulldozer when it comes to highway expansion. Or they're not being given proper trash cleanup by the three commissioner government. And that's largely because segregationists are on the committees. They're dominating the committees that are running the city. You can fast forward again to when DC residents are attempting to get a vote in Congress in the 70s through the 90s. And it's primarily Southern, now Republicans in the modern GOP, who are the primary opponents of DC getting a vote in Congress. People like Jesse Helms, who just says when the DC Voting Rights Amendment is before Congress in 1978, I'm not going to, you know, pander to a minority. I mean, he's talking about 700,000 people who don't have access to voting representation in Congress. It's not pandering to a minority. That's just code for saying I'm not going to give Black people political power, right? Tom DeLay says in 1993, when the statehood bill is before Congress, not only should we not give DC statehood, we should actually destroy the local government and go back to the three commissioner form of government. He's talking about DC being too liberal, too urban, too Black. And so race plays a huge role, both in how the city was mismanaged when it didn't have democratic governance, even home rule, and today in opposition to an expansion of democratic governance so that we have voting representation in Congress.
And just to add one thing, is that, you know, this is something that you hear among opponents of DC statehood. I mean, I heard it at the hearings when the bill was introduced in the House. You know, opponents will say, well, how could race have anything to do with it? DC had a white majority for you know, up until the 1950s. And, you know, so that just shows that race has nothing to do with it. But again, you know, as Derek was pointing out, even before 1957, when there's a black majority, what the fear was what happened in Reconstruction, where in an electorate where whites may be split evenly between two parties, the black vote that and black voters tended to vote as a block then and now in general for one party. Back then it was for the Republican Party. They held the balance of power, right? So whoever, whichever faction of that black voters chose would be the party in power, and they would become empowered. And that was true in Reconstruction, because when you have the vote, you can make demands on your political figures. And so almost immediately during Reconstruction, the police force is integrated, the firefighting department is integrated, about 30% of the city contracts go to black workers, right? So things change when you have power. And that's precisely what opponents of DC voting fear.
We have a question from Colleen, who says, do you think Americans realize that the White House and the United States Capitol, two symbolic beacons of democracy, were largely built by enslaved people? And in addition, how important do you think it is to share such information and stories with children studying American history, and how should we do this?
I think it's a good question, Colleen. You want to jump on it?
I'd say these days it depends on what state you live in, because some states are banning what they think they know as critical race theory, and what they really just want is a whitewashed version of American history. I don't think that probably the majority of American citizens know that slaves worked on, were part of the interracial free and slave work crews that worked on the White House and the Capitol. And I don't think that they understand that many of the people who built those buildings wanted slaves on those work sites, because they knew that the presence of slaves, a labor force that really had no bargaining power, right, could effectively help them to control the free labor on those sites, right? So white workers who wanted to strike because they wanted better pay, the folks who were building those buildings can just turn around and say, well, then we'll replace you with slaves. So like, shut up and keep working for what we're giving you. And they wrote about that. I mean, it's not like it's something that we divine. They actually talked about how slaves helped them to, the presence of slaves helped them to control free labor, black and white, right? And so, you know, it's important to tell the story, not just to say, well, slaves were there, but also to say that there's a larger strategy that slaves played a part in, or slaves were used as sort of a part of. And that is to control the larger working class population, black and white. And so I think it's terribly important to teach it. I don't think many people, however, know about it offhand. So you gotta get them a copy of Chocolate City.
So, but it's such a great question. And Colleen's question is really important about teaching this. And, you know, how do you do it? I mean, to me, you know, I'm not going to presume to talk for Derek, but, you know, the way you teach about it is to teach about it, right? You have to acknowledge, you have to just address it. And it's important to do so in the context of American history, and not as a sidebar, not as a little, African-American month, you know, we'll talk about this piece there. You know, an interesting story, our editors wanted us to release our book in February. They wanted to hold off until February to release the book, because they said, well, you know, this is Black History, and that's Black History Month, so it'll be appropriate to sell it in February, you know, release it in February, have a big event. And we were really insistent to say, no, this is American history. This is all of our history. This is history that everyone needs to know. Like, you cannot understand the city if you don't understand the role that race plays. You can't understand this country if you don't understand the role that race plays, and slavery in particular plays. This is the full story of American history. So you have to address it all year round and at all levels. And you can talk about slavery. I've got three little kids, right? We talk about slavery, we read about slavery, right? They understand fully the contradictions embedded in our country and how those contradictions, we've never fully reconciled them because we don't want to make ourselves uncomfortable. And that, you know, you hear this language actually written into some of this new legislation that's coming out, that where legislators are saying, we don't want to make white students feel uncomfortable. Well, yes, history should make you uncomfortable. And I'll add a corollary. There are folks on the left who are saying much of the same thing. They're saying, whoa, 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 whoa. We don't want to use certain language. We don't want to hear certain language because it's going to make some students feel uncomfortable. But we were approached by a college professor who wanted us to produce what he called a classroom version of Chocolate City that would be with all the offensive language taken out. Because we quote from historical sources, we use language that is not considered appropriate or polite today, because that's what's in the historical record. And we told that professor the same thing we would tell these right-wing legislators, which is, look, history is supposed to make us feel uncomfortable. If you can read about American history and slavery and segregation, not to mention genocide of Native Americans, like, if you can read that and feel comfortable, there's something wrong with you, right? You should be uncomfortable. This history should make you angry. It should make you act. And if it isn't, then we're not doing our jobs. And so, you know, we're not willing to dumb down the history or whitewash the history or take out the offensive language to make it palatable for people, right? This is the full story, and we got to teach it year round, you know, from the time the kids can start to read all the way up.
And I'll just add one other thing. I mean, I think when people use, you know, in amen to everything Chris said, I think when a lot of people use the word race, they automatically think black and white. And we were very conscious when we wrote the book that we were going to tell the story of race and governance in the district. And that meant including all of the different racialized groups that have occupied this space. And so we start the story with the theft of Native American land that allowed for the creation of the United States of America, including eventually the nation's capital. And we go all the way through and we talk about the Ethiopian population that has developed in Washington, D.C. in the late 20th century, the Latino population that forms around World War II, then grows and then heads out towards Prince George's and Montgomery counties. And so we want to make sure that we have all of those groups in there, because you just can't understand how Americans got this land and then how it was governed if you don't understand how race kind of greases the skids of those processes. And so Chris is absolutely right. It's literally not just adding race into the story of American democracy. It's understanding the story of American democracy through the lens of race, which oftentimes just makes it work, or makes it work in the interests of only some people and not in the interests of others.
I have a question from Evan, who says, you mentioned that DC became the first Black majority city. Was the Black experience unique because of this, or do you see patterns repeated as other cities grew?
Yeah, you see patterns repeated as other cities grow. I mean, you know, DC's experience is pretty unique because DC is unique. And so, you know, DC becomes the capital of Black America really back in the 1890s because Southern cities are getting this huge influx of African Americans. And so DC in a lot of ways looks like New Orleans, looks like Baltimore, looks like places like Chattanooga. But it gets the largest number because it's really one of the freer Southern cities that African Americans have access to, because Congress had set the pay rates for Black school teachers as being even with those of white school teachers. Because there's a civil service exam that, you know, essentially doesn't allow for racial discrimination. I mean, you submit the civil service exam and you pass it as an African American and do better than a white person, you can potentially get a better job, right? At like the printing office or something. That wouldn't always be the case. The Woodrow Wilson administration essentially begins to do away with a purely meritocratic system. But it's that moment that DC gets a little bit of a boost because of those peculiarities, but as part of a larger trend of Black folks moving into southern cities in the late 19th century. Same thing in the middle 20th century. The second Great Migration sends huge numbers of African Americans to northern and midwestern cities and swells their populations. And we really think that this is a sort of a timeless phenomenon, right? We think of cities and we think of African Americans in America today. But you know, that's a product of the World War II Great Migration for a couple of cities from the first Great Migration during World War I. DC doesn't really get a huge influx during World War I, but it's part of a larger national trend. Now, because DC is very southern, because it's and so it benefits both from the early migrations of the 19th century and then the second wave in the mid 20th, it gets to a majority population more quickly than some other northern cities. Also, because the federal government's in control, there's no local government to defend segregation. So when the Eisenhower administration decides that we really need to move towards desegregation because it's embarrassing to us in the international Cold War, by and large, it's done. And white DC residents don't have anyone to fight for them locally. And so what they do is they leave. I mean, 300,000 white DC residents leave the city between the end of World War I and the end of the 1960s. And that's primarily because they realize that there's no way to fight desegregation like they're able to do in many other cities around the country. And so they flee and they just head out to the suburbs where segregation is still the case. And so DC is special, but it is part of these larger national trends.
So we had so many great questions today. I'm gonna start wrapping it up, but I do have one final question for you. From myself. One of the things that I really enjoyed about this book is that it does a really great job of weaving together these smaller individual stories in the narrative of DC history, but also broader nation's history. And you profile really fascinating people like Alethea Browning Tanner, Marian Anderson, just so many different people. And I was wondering if you had a favorite story of an individual that you cover in this book, and if you would share it with us.
Chris, I'll jump in on that, you know, because the story I love that I really didn't know much about was about Sammy Abbott and Reginald Booker. Sammy Abbott was the guy that you were referencing before, who built his own house in Tacoma Park, Maryland, just across the DC line, because he did not want to live in a place where he had no vote. And so in the 1960s, he helped start what becomes one of the most successful protest movements of the era to stop the expansion of highways through the city. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to go back into the 1950s. I mean, highways were, you know, the sign of progress, the sign that the city was growing and developing. You had these spaghetti highways, you know, crisscrossing cities, you know, getting the folks that the federal government had been subsidizing to go out to the suburbs, getting them back in to shop and work and then go back home at the end of the day. But of course, those highways have to be built somewhere. And they were largely built, as Derek referenced before, over poor neighborhoods and Black neighborhoods and through Sammy Abbott's neighborhood in Tacoma Park, right? So there was a 10-lane North Central freeway that was being planned right through his house that he built with his father-in-law, and he wasn't going to do it. He wasn't going to let that happen. And so he started this little group called the Emergency Committee on the Transportation Crisis. He just starts knocking on doors, everybody in the path of that 10-lane highway. And the more he knocks, the more times it's a Black face that opens the door. And he meets this young guy in his 20s, Reginald Booker, who's a young Black man in, he works for the federal government, native Washingtonian. He'd grown up in Southwest DC until his house was destroyed by urban renewal and had to move out. And now his house was in the path of this freeway. And so he says, hell yes, I'm going to get involved. And the two of them become this tag team. Sammy Abbott's this little white guy with glasses and you know, bald with flowing white hair. And then Reginald Booker, who's this tall, lean, Black guy with a dashiki, you know, the picture of a Black nationalist of the late 1960s. The two of them, anywhere the bulldozer goes, there they are with their picket signs. They get students to chain themselves to trees. They're at every hearing. And over time, they win over lawyers to file lawsuits. And over time, what was inevitable in the early 1960s, becomes impossible by the early 1970s. And so the reason that we have so many of these wonderful neighborhoods, you know, Brooklyn and Tacoma, all these neighborhoods, a big reason we have those is because of the work of Sammy Abbott, Reginald Booker, and the Emergency Committee on the Transportation Crisis.
Yeah, I'll do a quick exclamation point to the end of Chris's story. He always says that we should have a statue where 395 hits New York Avenue of Sammy Abbott and Reginald Booker saying, stop, because they literally stopped a highway that was under construction that was supposed to plow through the center of the city. I mean, it's a remarkable story. And I always hate that I have to tell mine after Chris, because he always tells it so well. So I think, you know, my character that I just really fell in love with while writing the book, and I'm actually writing about him in my next book project, is Walter Fauntroy. You know, Walter Fauntroy is sort of a favorite son of middle-class Washington, D.C. He grew up in middle-class Shaw, you know, doing like soapbox derbies and you know, being the favorite child of New Bethel Baptist Church, where he eventually became the minister. He had this beautiful tenor voice, and so they'd get him up in the pulpit to sing, you know, The Impossible Dream, and he would do it well into his congressional career as an adult. And what I love about Fauntroy is that, you know, he's this little man with this high voice who decides that he is going to punch way above his weight. And so, you know, Chris talks about Alethea Tanner. I mean, here you have a person who, you know, is trying to figure out how to maneuver in a society where all of the arrows of power are pointing away from her, not towards her. And Fauntroy has a similar situation. I mean, he's a relatively privileged individual as compared to Tanner, but he's trying to figure out how DC residents get home rule and then get a vote in Congress. And there is no power in the city by and large. I mean, power is the ability to punish one's enemies and to reward one's friends. And if you look at the money or the actual, you know, sort of access to levers of power that DC street activists, because there are no elected officials when he starts doing this, have. I mean, it's really none. But he decides that he's going to start working with Dr. King, because he's a member of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, and bringing Dr. King to town to sort of push for Lyndon Johnson's home rule bill, which they do in 1965. And then he founds a group called the Coalition of Conscience, which begins to focus on lobbying for DC home rule locally. In the early 1970s, he realizes that there's basically one person who is leading the coalition that's holding up home rule legislation. It's a guy named John McMillan from South Carolina, who's an arch segregationist. He realizes too that the Voting Rights Act that he had fought for and Dr. King had fought for and all these other Southern civil rights activists had fought for had empowered about 20% of John McMillan's previously disfranchised Black constituents. And so he starts traveling to South Carolina to get those Black people to care about DC home rule and to tell their representative to stop blocking home rule legislation. And he goes one better in 1972 and actually backs one of John McMillan's opponents, and they defeat the guy. And so when John McMillan loses, he's no longer the chair of the DC committee in the House, able to block DC home rule legislation. The person that fills that position is Charlie Diggs, who's a Black congressman from Detroit and a good friend of Walter Fauntroy. And so the first thing that Charlie Diggs does is puts home rule legislation on the calendar. And within 3 years of John McMillan being defeated, with the help of Walter Fauntroy and local activists that he had bussed down there, we're voting for a council and a mayor, and they're getting seated here in Washington, D.C. So Walter Fauntroy is like, that's not enough. I want two senators and a voting member of the House. And he starts lobbying African Americans, not just in South Carolina, but around the country, to pressure their elected officials to vote for the DC Voting Rights Amendment, which was an amendment that would have treated DC as though it were a state for purposes of representation. And they organized so well, they get people like Strom Thurmond, the arch segregationist, to vote for an amendment that would have guaranteed two Black people get elected into the Senate, which, by the way, would have increased the number of Black people in the Senate by 200%, right? Because there was only one there at the time. And so, you know, it's really, really impressive work. He was not successful in getting us voting representation in the House. New right activists actually killed the DC Voting Rights Amendment before the states. But he was able, with no money, to get the DC Voting Rights Amendment supermajority votes in Congress and send it to the states for ratification. It's a remarkable story, and I think that it really gives us some wonderful lessons as we struggle for statehood today.
Well, thank you guys so much for joining us this evening. This has been a wonderful conversation. I encourage everyone in our audience to pick up a copy of Chocolate City, A History of Race and Democracy in the Nation's Capital. And if you're local to the district, consider picking up a copy at a local bookstore like Sankofa Bookstore, Mahogany Books, Politics and Prose, or Busboys and Poets. You can also find them on Twitter at GD Musgrove and at Chris Myers Asch. Thank you all for joining us tonight, and you can join us next month again for White House History Live on Tuesday, July 13th at 5 p.m., where we will be discussing Kai Bird's book, The Outlier, The Unfinished Presidency of Jimmy Carter. Thank you all for joining us this evening. Good night.
Thanks, everyone.